And there was for 8 days, and no lights, no nothing. There was a dog named Smokey, you see. And it was very frustrating, to say the least.
Now, you couldn't get out of there even to walk out, right?
No, we had to climb the fence.
Oh my God.
I mean, I was just stuck, and me and the dog and fireflies that I had never seen before. And in the book, I called them flies with light bulbs up their butt. Then last year, I went into a standing elk from one of the elders from the Lakota elders, and he explained the purpose of the firefly people, that so when they appear to you, it's a real sacred purpose, that they show you what course to take and which way to
Right.
go, and you have no choice other than to do that.
Well,
And that's what happened.
yeah, you didn't have any other choice. You know, I find that very interesting because where I grew up back east, and there were fireflies back there, and I played with them, and I mean, they were what signified the fact that evening was coming, was that these little bugs would come out with their little lights. And then I got to the Midwest and the West Coast, and there are no fireflies at all. I've never seen them on the West Coast at all. So when I read about them in your book and you were talking about, where was she? There's fireflies there. But bugs with light bulbs up their butt is
That's
not
what I
real
call
complimentary.
But I didn't know what else to call them, you
Well,
know?
that's kind of what they look like. That's true.
And so I didn't have a name for them. So it was very symbolic. And I almost forgot the original questions.
Well, I was
But
my question was, what are you planning to do next? You know, what else are you going to do with the show? I mean, you've traveled all over the place.
Right.
You've interviewed all these strange people.
Yeah.
What's the next step as far as the show is
At the time of, if I answer your question here now, I am stuck between two buildings
concerned?
because I'm not in control right now.
Right.
I plan on going to Philadelphia. Now, that's pretty much set to teach a class for a turbo class for a friend. And then I guess I just go with the flow and see where it's taken me.
But don't you notice that? Now, this has just been my experience, and I've been doing the RVing longer than you have, but you've been doing the TV shows longer than I have.
I got the RV idea from you.
Right.
Yeah.
And what I've noticed with that part of it is that if you set a goal out here, if you say, you know, I'm going to do whatever, you know, I'm going to do this thing, whatever that thing is. If you decide that you're going to do that thing, but you don't know how you're going to get there,
Right.
somehow spirit fixes it
It
so
fix
that
it.
you get there, so that it all works
Yeah.
somehow and it all just kind of flows.
It will fix it. Before we went on the air here, we were talking about the gas prices
Yeah.
because we have no funding, you know, none whatsoever. And so there was a time I was down to 4 gallons of gas in the middle of nowhere, and I needed a Conoco. That's the credit card I had. And
Right.
there was a Conoco.
Yeah.
I filled up on the way back. I thought, well, I might as well get gas here before I get to the other interstate. And well, what happened was the station was no longer there. In fact, it had never been there at all, and it was not on my bill.
That is awesome.
It was awesome. Yeah,
That is
65
awesome.
gallons of gas without, you know, that was
In
pretty
a
good.
non-existent gas station.
Yeah.
Well, I was telling you that I had a
Yeah.
similar experience, although mine, I gave them money, so I assumed that, you
Yeah.
know, it must have gone into the cosmic bank. But
The cosmic.
I take 100 gallons at a time, and I was down to very little. And I was driving along going, okay, I think I've probably got another 10 miles or so, and I'm going to need to get gas. But everywhere I had seen it was $2 and something a gallon, and I had put on my stubborn hat, and I just didn't want to pay $2 and something a gallon for gas. And literally, I mean, usually you see ARCOs and those kind, because I pay cash, and so usually you see ARCOs and those kinds of stations in town. I mean, there's like a lot of other stuff around them. There's McDonald's and Burger King and, you know, I don't know, a Pilot Station and a Love's, and there's all this stuff around them. I was driving down the freeway, And there's a flashing sign on the side of the freeway that says AM, PM. Mm-hmm. And it says $1.39 a gallon. So I pulled off and filled up at $1.39 a gallon, where every other gas station I had seen before, and actually every one I saw after that for another 400 and some miles, was around $2 a gallon.
Is it amazing how?
So you just set the tone. You go, okay, this is where I want to go, God. And either I think that spirit like drops money in your lap so that you have enough money to do whatever it is that you want to do, or they put whatever it is that you need at the price that you can afford to pay for it.
Have you ever stopped the gas needle at a certain point?
I haven't done that one.
I have.
I was running on memories there for a while, though. Now you think you're going somewhere, but you're not sure because your life is kind of in flux right now. The other thing that I wanted to ask you about that you mentioned just in passing as we were coming in to do this was that you do shows on the internet. Now mine is streaming audio, but yours is something else. What is yours?
It is called Psygeria Uncensored, and We're working on downloading it now. We've taped a couple of them already, and you can access it at my webpage, which is www.psygeria.com. I think it'll be shown at the end of the show.
Right.
And there will come a time where you can actually access this internet show. And like the two we taped had to do with mind control and government abductions. And so are going to be some that is going to be a little more on the edge than I might be able to get away with, even on public access.
Well, actually, you can probably get away just about anything on public access, but you have a larger audience on the internet.
Yes, you do.
But you're shooting these shows specifically for the internet. So are you shooting them at a studio? Is it one camera or two?
It's two cameras, and it's, of course, it's not as elaborate as we do in the studio here,
right.
You know, because the purpose is really the information rather than
the glitz.
Right. But, you know, you have to have the glitz because if it's boring,
people
lose
watch.
Interest.
Exactly.
So I like the glitz and the strangeness of, and the madness of the shows.
Right.
Yeah.
But the ones that are done, I'm so curious about the ones that are on the internet. So you go to a studio in Colorado or somewhere.
In Colorado.
And you guys, is it a studio like the studios for Access Television? Are they?
No, it's a private studio.
Oh, they're private studios.
Yeah, it's a private studio, very simple.
And then they take the information, they edit it into video format, and then they put it on the internet?
Right, and download it to the web page. Actually,
so the people can go there and listen to it anytime?
At any time, yeah. Uh-huh. Now, actually, if you go to my web page and go on to the TL Rampa, that's A-R-A-M-A, Rampa. From what I understand, some of my shows are linked to the Rampa page, so where you could actually see, I believe it's two or three of the Olympia shows that ended up on the Rampa.
Okay, now see
list.
The ones that you're doing with me, like this one is going to be, but it's not the same way. Like yours is, they can go to that site anytime, and they can click in and they can watch the show. For me, they can only watch it during the times that my shows are aired in Tucson.
Uh-huh, yeah.
So on Sundays from 3 to 4 and Thursdays from 9 to 10, they can go and click on the Vortex on my website, and it will take them to Access Tucson, and they hit Channel 72, and they can see it. The rest of the time, if they go there, somebody told me, they said, I got some lady singing opera. That wasn't you.
Yeah.
Yeah, because Access, of course, has all kinds of different things that they show.
Yeah.
So but for yours, they're always there.
They're always there.
I like that. But that company that does that, they're only doing conspiracy stuff. Is that the idea?
No, they accommodate pretty much what I want to do. And so, but I, in the studio, we do a lot of shows of spiritual nature. We've covered the indigo children. We've had children. Wow. We've had cats, and I've taken them to the dog show. So
that might be interesting. Cats at the dog show.
Yeah, we're not really limited,
to
anything other than finances sometimes.
So. Right, right. That's pretty fascinating, though, to be able to do that. Now, you're doing that. The other thing I want to know, because you have so many different topics that you cover, mm-hmm. how do you select your guest?
I don't. They just find me. After the earthquake, I did one of two earthquake shows where we wanted to tell the friends out, in the rest of the country, some of the things that we had arrived at. And I was sleeping, and I woke up, and in my mind, my head just said, go buy some bug spray. Now, keep in mind, I don't have a house, so I know I don't need bug spray. But I said, okay, so I went to get bug spray. And I'm coming down one aisle, and the young man is coming down the other aisle, and he smiled, and he said, hi. And I said, I wish I was. Mm-hmm. And he said, lady, if you're getting ready to have this raid, this bug spray, that's not the way to go. And I said, what is your name? And he said, Sage. And my mind said, aha. I said, where do you live and what do you do? And he said, well, I'm sort of hanging out in Olympia. By choice, I'm a homeless person. And sure, I can do a show. And that's all that I had, his name. And we did a wonderful show. No dialogue before or after the show.
Right.
It turned out just fine.
So that you basically, again, that's the setting the intention. Your intention is to produce one show a week and to have a new show every week. And so Spirit does what it takes in order for you to have that. Mm-hmm.
Exactly. And sometimes I have scheduled one person and something happens and they can't make it. Because for some strange reason, I seem to be 2 weeks ahead of the regular news with topics and things that's going on. And
it's just 2 weeks.
2 weeks. Uh-huh. And then, of course, sometimes the programming director is going to make a mistake, and he doesn't play it on the day that I think he should. But in hindsight, it's always
on
perfect.
Time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's kind of interesting, though. You run 2 weeks. Now, I haven't done it with my show because I was advised to do my show and run the same show for a month. It was my ambition to do one a week the way you do. And maybe a few years from now when I grow up and I have 100 shows under my belt, I can do that. But right now I'm running one show a month. But when you set your tone and say that, I'm going to do one show a week and this is who, I'm going to have people on. Do you somehow do any kind of conscious visualization or anything like that to say, okay, God, you need to send me somebody? No.
No, it's back to Bernie. When we leave the studio, and he'll just say, here you go, lady. And I turn it in. And in however order that they pick it up or turn it in, that's how we play it.
That's awesome.
Yeah, it is, isn't it?
Well, yeah, it's awesome in two respects. One, that it works out so well, but also that you're able to let go. That you're able to let go enough to let it work that well. Because, and also, I guess you've got to say something for the station, too, that they are loose enough in that respect to, that they don't have to know every little thing and exactly what you're doing and how you're doing it and whatnot.
I would think that they pretty much know, that they got a handle on that.
Well, they know you're going to show up with a show every week.
Yeah. But the other nice thing is, you see, originally I came on at 9 p.m. And then somewhere along the line, the time frame changed to 9:30, which was not a good thing because I lost some of the viewers. But in the meantime, some of my viewers have gotten a little older, and they had to go to nursing homes. And so 9 o'clock was too late for them to look at it. And so the station arranged it where I would repeat. I repeat that show from Thursday on Friday morning at 11 o'clock.
Awesome.
So they get to watch it. So
you've picked up new audience. And you've been able to retain some of your old ones because you're on twice now.
And then some of my camera people are children.
I have
a lot of workers that are children. And so when they're home from school, they get to watch their work.
That is so cool.